And now, the Edwin Black Show. Sponsored by the books of Edwin Black. Available on Amazon and at booksellers worldwide. And now, here's Edwin.
Welcome to the Edwin Black Show. I'm Edwin Black, investigative journalist and historian and author of IBM and the Holocaust, my bestseller on eugenics, war against the weak, the Farhud, and many other books. If you like what we are doing, tell a friend. This is a retake of the original episode because Zoom technology failed us. We've had viewers today from across America and overseas. In addition, I think those in schools and elsewhere who are sharing their screen with colleagues are multiplying our audience greatly. If you like what we are doing, as I say, tell a friend. We hope to include as many of you as possible everywhere in our episodes. We have accrued several fascinating questions for our panelists. The Edwin Black Show is growing and growing globally. We speak to a fragmented world seeking better understanding of our tormented past, our present very tense, and a future still uncertain. The show is brought to you by an all-volunteer group across many cities here and in several countries. If you possess skills and talents and wish to join us, go to Join the team at edwinblackshow.com. It's an email, join the team at theedwinblackshow.com. Also, we ask all of our viewers to subscribe at our YouTube channel at The Edwin Black Show, and be sure to hit that notify button. After this episode, our production team adds all sorts of graphics to create a highly enhanced rendition of the episode. That takes some time, so we have been rushing them out to our YouTube channel. If you missed an earlier episode, go over there now, and I'm sure you'll see it listed. And remember, when you go to the YouTube channel, subscribe and hit notify. Now to today's episode. Farhud. It's an Arabic-Kurdish dialect meaning violent dispossession. The word describes a blood-curdling massacre by Nazi-allied Arabs against Baghdad's peaceful Jewish community on June 1 and June 2, 1941. The ensuing mass rape, beheading, murder, burning, and looting spree was the first step in a process that throughout the Arab world effectively ended some 2,600 years of Jewish existence in those lands. Ultimately, some 850,000 to 900,000 Jews were systematically pauperized and made stateless in a coordinated forced exodus from the Arab world. Many Sephardic Jews consider the 1941 Farhud, which murdered and maimed hundreds, to be their Kristallnacht. However, more than 70 years, neither the facts about the brutal two-day pogrom nor the culpability of the Nazified Iraqi and other Arab perpetrators led by the Mufti of Jerusalem, Hajj Amin al-Husseini, leader of the Arab community in Mandate Palestine, nor the expulsion of 850,000 Jewish refugees from the Arab world that followed were topics the UN wanted to hear of. Nor for more than 70 years was this bloodletting and its aftermath commemorated in the vast chronicles of organized Holocaust remembrances. Nor was this constellation of tragedies commonly known and/or spoken of within the Jewish community. In fact, it took years of highly acrimonious, sometimes public debate with and pressure on the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum, which only recently was induced to recognize either the atrocity that occurred or the Mufti's role in the killing as a Holocaust-era persecution. Indeed, the Farhud is most often referred to as the forgotten pogrom. I first wrote about this massacre in a fleeting passage in my 2004 book, Banking on Baghdad. My articles on the subject in the media, drawn from the book, such as those syndicated by the Jewish Telegraphic Agency, were typically headlined, The Forgotten Pogrom. That spawned the 2005 Farhud Recognition Project, which endeavored to bring this brutal Holocaust chapter into history's sight lines. Half a decade later, in 2010, I went further and published an entire book devoted to the topic. It's the Farhud Roots of the Arab Nazi Alliance in the Holocaust. Here it is, ladies and gentlemen. Yet 10 years after being rediscovered, and right through the week before a special UN event to proclaim International Farhud Day, Jewish media articles were still referring to the Farhud as the Forgotten Pogrom. Conference of Presidents Vice Chairman Malcolm Hohenlein, in his introductory remarks at that June 1, 2015 UN event, poignantly asked this question: I must wonder why it took 74 years for the world to recognize the tragedy of the Farhud. Certainly, that was the question of the day. Three main reasons explain how mass carnage, as barbaric as the Farhud, remained out of earshot and over the horizon of Holocaust awareness. First, persecution of Jewish victims in Arab countries did not conform to the established line of study that followed the classic Holocaust definition as archetypically expressed by the Holocaust Museum's mission statement. I quote, "The Holocaust was the state-sponsored systematic persecution and annihilation of European Jewry by Nazi Germany and its collaborators between 1933 and 1945. Note the pivotal word European. This geographic qualifier left out the Jews of Iraq, as well as their persecuted co-religionists in North Africa, where some 17 concentration camps were established by Vichy allied and Nazi-influenced Arab regimes. Second, because the persecution of Jews in Arab lands during World War II and their forced exodus was considered beyond the thematic horizon, the type of well-financed and skilled scholarship that has riveted world attention on the Holocaust in Europe generally bypassed the Sephardic experience. Certainly, the overwhelming blood and eternal sorrow of the Holocaust genocide was experienced by European Jewry, but their deeply tragic suffering, including that endured by my Polish parents who survived, does not exclude the examination of other groups. After the 1941 Farhud and during the subsequent years, Husseini was on Hitler's payroll. The Mufti of Jerusalem toured European concentration camps and intervened at the highest levels to send European children to death camps in occupied Poland rather than see them rescued into Mandate Palestine. In his diary, Husseini called Adolf Eichmann, quote, a rare diamond. What's more, the tens of thousands of Nazified Arabs who fought in three Waffen-SS divisions in the Balkans and across all of Europe were fighting for a Palestine and a greater Middle East Arab cause that hinged on Jewish extermination and colonial upheaval. When I wrote the Farhud in 2010, the focus then was on excavating the details of a forgotten pogrom and a forgotten Nazi alliance. Only in recent years has a renewed trickle of excellent scholarship yielded gripping new research into the Arab role in the Holocaust. There are several excellent books out now. Third, critics say that many of the leading Jewish newspapers and wire services, now vastly more politicized than they were in the prior decade, did not devote sufficient space and informed knowledge to the topic. Moreover, some of these critics suggest that in recent years, the Jewish press seemed to have marginalized the atrocity and its aftermath as a political discussion. Quote, when former Deputy Foreign Minister Danny Ayalon was doing his 2012 campaign for Jewish refugees from Arab lands, asserted Lyn Julius of the British organization Harif. Hardly a day went by when certain Jewish or Israeli newspapers did not politicize the matter or suggest Israel was exploiting the issue for political gain, close quote. In that vein, the day before the June 1st, 2015 UN event, in which we proclaimed International Farhud Day, one prominent Jewish newspaper published an article on the Farhud, which included this observation. Now, Jewish organizations and the Israeli government deploy it, meaning memory of the Farhud, frequently to support their claims for refugee recognition on behalf of Middle Eastern Jews, close quote. Before the UN ceremony that day, 5 years ago, three different irate members of the audience showed me this article on their tablets, and the consensus of disdain was expressed by one Sephardic gentleman who objected, first quoting the newspaper with derision, deploy it frequently to support their claims for refugee recognition on behalf of Middle Eastern Jews. And then he added, they would never say such a thing about the European Kristallnacht. The complainers were equally astonished that this prominent article made no mention of the Mufti of Jerusalem. They felt the complete omission of Husseini's involvement and the marginalization of their nightmare was typical of the roadblocks they had encountered during their decades-long struggle for recognition of their anguish. But on June 1st, 2015, yes, back then, it was 74 inexcusable years late, and yes, not an hour too soon, after waiting for 30 minutes beneath a gaggle of umbrellas in the torrential rain at a narrow admittance gate on First Avenue, and then into a packed hall at the UN, attended by diplomats from several countries, human rights activists of various causes, and key Jewish leaders from a communal spectrum, in an event broadcast worldwide live by the UN itself, the stalwarts of Farhud memory gathered to finally make the proclamation of International Farhud Day, and they made it loud and clear. In doing so, they made history by simply recognizing history. All they wanted was to be remembered and to change the headline on their suffering from the forgotten pogrom to the not forgotten pogrom. All they wanted was to draw back the curtain of their sorrow without an asterisk, without a parenthetical, without a quote, but also unquote, or a however, or a political catchphrase to qualify or filter their disconsolation. In short, they wanted to take their place in the annals of misery for the same reason all other Jews gather into that space, so they can help whisper endlessly the words never again as a beacon to humanity. That happened, International Farhud Day, on June 1st, 2015, 74 years too late, but not a minute too soon. The official proclamation was read aloud that day to the world. I'll read it now. On behalf of Iraqi Jews everywhere who yearn to commemorate the Farhud, the Holocaust-era massacre by Arab nationalists in coordination with the Nazis, which occurred June 1 to 2, 1941, in Baghdad, killing hundreds of innocent Jews and brutalizing thousands more and pillaging their property. And on behalf of those who recognize that Palestinian Arab leaders, including the Grand Mufti of Jerusalem, Haj Amin al-Husseini, were central instigators of the violence in Baghdad, along with Iraqi Prime Minister Rashid Ali al-Galiani and the Golden Square coup plotters. And on behalf of those who yearn to recognize that the Farhud was the first step in the process which resulted in the forced exodus of 850,000 to 900,000 Jewish refugees from centuries of peaceful existence in Arab countries, the organizations and individuals assembled and represented here this June 1, 2015 in New York City at the United Nations do hereby proclaim June 1st as International Farhud Day to recognize and commemorate the Nazi-allied massacre by Arabs, the forced mass the mass forced exodus that followed and the 850,000 to 900,000 Jewish refugees from Arab lands. We recognize this date as a lamented day of history that should not be forgotten, close quote. While I was speaking that day to the packed room, a woman I did not know, sitting in the front row, slowly shook her tear-stained head in disbelief and muttered softly, barely audible, "I never thought I would hear those words in this building." On behalf of Congress in the House of Representatives, co-chair Representative Trent Franks issued a public statement expressing, quote, "deepest solidarity with Iraqi and the Arab world's Jews. We will change the 1st of June from a day of near forgotten tragedy into an international Farhud day, a day of commemoration when we call on the entire world to remember the disaster that befell the Arab world's Jews and to do justice by them and their descendants." Those who know the complex relations and brimming calendar of the Jewish communal scene would understandably guess that such an international and multi-organizational undertaking as a live global event, no less, would necessitate many months of tedious planning and probably a grant or two from the donor community. In fact, the entire enterprise took just 6 weeks from the first light bulb email on April 9th to the culminating applause of Farhud Day on June 1st, 2015. As a testament to the long overdue recognition and the deep-seated and visceral understanding of the tragedy, uncharacteristically, the prime movers came together immediately, cohesively, and with humanitarian synchrony. There was no real funding except for the shoestring contributions of the participants, a team of volunteers were found to man the event, and my end was simply the history and making sure it came to life. Remember, history, when connected to the present, can be a spark plug for the future. The Israeli Foreign Ministry has now devoted a page to International Farhud Day. Google added the day to their online calendar. Within 48 hours of the event, a simple Google search yielded more than 5,000 entries for, quote, International Farhud Day. Today, that is over 100,000 entries. The event is now observed around the world. From that very rainy moment, June 1st, 2015 at the UN, and going forward, memories of the day of that day in Baghdad when it burned in 1941 became no longer invisible, muffled, or parenthesized. The long, painful threnody of the Holocaust that never lacks for cadenzas now includes a refrain for the Jews of Baghdad and 850,000 of their co-religionists across the Arab world, for whom the persecution never stopped when the Third Reich was toppled in May 1945. For them, forevermore, we have imbued an added dimension in a macabre cubist process that never lacks for additional dimensions when we look out, look back, and look within to intone the haunting, always wafting injunction, never again. To understand more today, now, I have invited three warriors for history. The first warrior is Lily Shor in Tel Aviv of the Babylonian Jewry Heritage Center, whose family came from Iraq. The second warrior is my friend Lyn Julius, an early fighter for the cause who heads up an organization called Harif, that is the UK Association of Jews from the Middle East and North Africa. She wrote a terrific book on the topic, Uprooted. Third is the eminent Rabbi Elie Abadie in New York, who has been fighting on this issue through the organization Justice for Jews from Arab countries. I'm going to start now with Lily. Lily, take it away.
Hello, Edwin, and hello, everybody. Thank you for the opportunity to introduce myself, my family, and the subject. I was born in Baghdad in 1957, and it was a time of a lot of coup d'etats, a lot of changes. The monarchy was thrown down, and it was a really difficult time for the small Jewish community who stayed there, remained there in Iraq after the big Aliyah of 1950-1951. So the community was about 9,000 Jews in 1951. And it was reduced to about 3,000 to 2,500 Jews in the Six Days War in 1967. And then the big change occurred. The regime, the Ba'athist regime of Saddam Hussein and his friends, they wanted to take revenge from the Jews and started to throw the Jews to jail, to prison, to accuse them of espionage and other things, other accusations. The Jews were not allowed anymore to go to universities. The telephone lines were cut from the houses. The Jews could not go around or to travel anymore. No passport, permissions to go to travel outside the country or outside the city, even outside Baghdad.
And all of this was done because you and your family were Jewish, correct?
Correct, because the Jews were the the target or the ultimate target of persecution and of revenge. The Jews are the the most convenient target to draw away the attention from other things like the Six Days War and the loss of the Arab armies and the Iraqi army, also the Iraqi forces who also fought in this world, took part in the battles in the war.
Now, right now you are speaking from Israel, correct?
Yes, of course, I'm speaking from Israel. I am Israeli, proud Israeli, I can say.
And you also represent the Babylonian Heritage Museum, correct?
Yes, I am the International Relations Manager and Events.
Tell us about that museum if people go to Israel and want to learn more, or if they wish to reach out to you on the internet. What does the museum do?
The museum, the Babylonian Jewry Heritage Center, was established in the early 70s. And was opened to the public as museum in the late 80s. We have a research center or research institute. We have a library and we have a museum, two stories of a museum, two floors. And in the museum, we start from 2700 BC. When the first exile by the Assyrian king took place. And we continue with the historical stories, with historical events written in the Bible, in the Holy Book, with Ezekiel the prophet, Ezra, Sofer, the final exile of the Babylonian king, in which all the Jews from the kingdom of Yehuda were taken as slaves to Babylon. And now, it continues all the exhibitions until today.
In this museum, you also have recreations of some of the streets of Baghdad, do you not? So people could see how your community lived, correct?
Yes, right. We have replica, we can say, of a small or a narrow alley, a narrow street, typical to the neighborhoods in Iraq, in Baghdad, in Basra, and other places, other cities in which the Jews used to live. There were 135,000 Jews in the first half of the century, of the 20th century, and 77,000 Jews lived in Baghdad. There were many, many neighborhoods that the Jews were the majority in them. Okay. And we can go, also we have a replica of the big synagogue, the great synagogue, which the Jews of the Babylonian Jews believe it was built in the 5th century BCE, and in the foundation, the people who came, or the Jews who came from the kingdom of Judah as slaves, brought with them sand and soil from the Eretz HaKodesh, from Jerusalem, from Zion, and stones and ashes from the burnt temple, And they put all this these in the under the foundation, in the foundations of the synagogue. So it is very symbolic to the longing and to the connection to Zion and to Jerusalem and to the land, to the Holy Land.
Let me take it now to London, and thank you so much, Lily, for that very compelling personal description. Lyn, you and I have worked together on many projects involving the Farhud going back many, many years. And I want to thank you for joining us. Now, you've written a book called Uprooted. Is that correct? Can I see a copy?
Sure. I'll give you his copy, Uprooted.
Yes.
It was published in 2018. It's now in a Norwegian edition, and shortly it'll go into Arabic translation.
Oh, that's amazing. That's amazing. So tell us how you feel about International Farhud Day and the whole situation.
Well, first of all, I'd like to thank you, Edwin, not just for having me here, but for what you've done to make sure that this terrible pogrom in June 1941 is not forgotten. And I think International Farhud Day was a tremendous initiative. It was long overdue. And I hope that next year, which is the 80th anniversary of the Farhud, we shall make an even bigger splash internationally, because the events that occurred in the Middle East and affected the Jewish communities are just not known, or they are suppressed. I mean, you touched on some of the reasons why the Farhud was forgotten or ignored. I think one is that the Holocaust is seen very much as an exclusively European event. And it's, and of course, you know, whatever affected Jews outside Europe, you can't compare the impact, you know, when 6 million European Jews died. But I would say it's very important because the legacy of the Farhud is still with us. It shows a sort of eliminationist anti-Semitism on the part of the Mufti of Jerusalem, who of course came from Palestine and wrought havoc in Iraq. It shows that the Farhud was definitely an anti-Semitic event. It was not an anti-Zionist event. I mean, you might characterize the riots that occurred in 1920, 1921, 1929 even in Palestine as perhaps anti-Zionist events. But what the Mufti did was he took his hatred of Jews outside Palestine and he directed it against Jews as Jews. These Jews in Iraq had nothing to do with Palestine. In fact, they continually declared their loyalty to the state of Iraq, their opposition to Zionism, but it didn't help. In the end, all Jews were fair game for murder. And I think this sort of eliminationist anti-Semitism is still very much with us today. You can find it in this refusal to compromise, intransigence on the part of certain Palestinians. You can find it in Islamist anti-Semitism, jihadist anti-Semitism, which and anti-Semitism generally is at the core of their ideology, I do believe.
All right. Well, I think that what you're saying is absolutely correct. What's key here is that the Mufti of Jerusalem, who was the leader of the Palestinian Arabs, and of course we only use the word Palestinian now, back then the Palestinians were known as the Jewish Zionists and the Arabs were known as the Arabs, but since 1964 they've rebranded themselves to be Palestinians when the PLO was invented. But the Mufti of Jerusalem exported his hatred of the Jews and brought that to Baghdad. And here you have a completely separate population, which was victimized, a completely loyal to Iraq population, a completely non-Zionistic population, which had been thriving in Mesopotamia for 2,600 years, 1,000 years before Muhammad, and they were victimized by their neighbors. Well, thank you very much. And let me turn now to my good friend, Rabbi Elie Abadie, who's been a major warrior in the effort to gain justice for Jews from Arab countries. In fact, that's the name of his organization. And he was with me shoulder to shoulder at the UN when we declared International Farhud Day. Rabbi, thank you for joining us. What's your take?
Thank you very much first, my dear friend Edwin, for all your work on behalf of Jews from Arab countries, on behalf of Iraqi Jews who suffered under the Farhud. And thank you for always putting me together, including me, in all of those important activities on behalf of Sephardic and Middle Eastern Jewry. So, the Farhud, I remember when 5 years ago we commemorated and we declared June 1st as the International Farhud Day. The Farhud was not an aberration in Arab countries. The aberration or the difference between that uprising against the Jews and any other uprising against the Jews throughout the history of the Jews living in Arab countries, and especially after the establishment of the State of Israel, is that this Farhud, this event was tied to Nazi Germany. It was Nazi inspired, as you have written so well and spoken about it many times. It was Nazi inspired, and where Haj Amin al Husseini, the Nazi sympathizer, friend of Hitler, took advantage of that and riled up his people in Iraq to rise against the Jewish community there. Of course, there are many factors that that contributed to the Farhud. There is a 1958 study by the Iraqi historian Abd al-Razzaq al-Hassani about the factors that contributed to the Farhud. So he writes that there were acts of incitement by the anti-Semitic German envoy in Baghdad, Dr. Fritz Grobe, who, as you said, is really a Borg, whose last name is really a Borg, but changed to Grobe. Also, the activities of Haj Amin al-Husseini and his retinue, who succeeded in influencing religious, educational, and military leaders to rise against the Jews. There were also incitement by Syrian and Palestinian teachers in their schools against the Jews. Nothing more different than the same incitement that takes place in UNRWA schools of the Arab Palestinians in Gaza and Jenin and Ramallah and other places where they incite students of kindergarten and elementary school to kill Jews and to attack Jews. There was also propaganda broadcasts in Arabic from Berlin to incite the population against the Jews. Of course, there were also false reports spread by the Iraqi radio about anti-Arab activities by Jews in Palestine at that time. And a part of that propaganda campaign was, of course, against the Jews. Of course, that was a false propaganda, but again, is to incite the Arab street and the Arab population against the Jews in the Farhud. And lastly, as it has been spoken already about, that several youth brigades, such as Al-Futuwa, the youthfulness, and Kata'ib al-Shabab, youth battalions, which were taught Nazi philosophy by their instructors, similar way that the brown shirts of Germany at the beginning, before the war, and also at the beginning of World War II. So all of those things really contributed to incite the population against the Jewish population in Iraq. Unfortunately, as you know, the powers to be stood by the side, allowing this to happen, especially the British forces, and they did not really lift up a finger, which reminds me very much as it happened the same thing in November 30th, December 1st and 2nd, in all of Arab countries after the partition plan of November 29th, 1947, of Palestine. And my mother, who lived there, saw everything happening, how Arab youth jumped over the synagogue, broke the doors open, took the Torah scrolls out, the books, the chumashim, the Bible books, they burned them, and then they took the rabbi out of the synagogue, who they carried him as he was hiding there. The synagogue was really next door to my mother and my father's house, and my parents' house, and they saw all happening, and they saw Syrian military people and Syrian police helping the rioters to climb over the wall, over the fence of the synagogue, and helping them to knock down doors of Jewish businesses and Jewish homes. So that was, of course, that took place 6 years later. But as I said, the Farhud is not much different than anything else that happened for the last, I would say, 400 years in Arab countries. But the difference is that the Farhud was Nazi-inspired with Nazi philosophy.
Well, that's a tremendous insight and just deepens the grievance to realize that this was just one of a constellation of such atrocities. But what made this one special was it was fully intertwined with the Nazi movement, consciously intertwined. Well, we've got quite a few questions here. Let's get to them right now. This is from Stephanie in Oak Park. Was the Mufti of Jerusalem ever tried or punished for his crimes? Lynn, you could take a crack at that.
Right. Well, of course, he wasn't. He actually got away with it at Nuremberg. He should have been tried at the very least for the massacres he provoked in Yugoslavia. You know, his SS units were brutal and cruel and committed terrible atrocities. So he should have been tried as a war criminal. He was allowed to escape by the French. He ended up in Cairo, and he ended up dying in his bed in 1974. And
and publishing many books. And I remember when the move was on to indict him for war crimes, the politicians at the time said, we need the oil. And as a result of that, he was given a pass. And of course, the Jews didn't get very much help from the UN at that time when it came time for standing up to the Mufti. So fill us in, Rabbi Abadie. Was the Mufti of Jerusalem ever tried or punished for his crimes?
Unfortunately, as you know, he was not. He was not tried. He was let be and was alive till the 70s, where he died in his bed in Egypt, as far as I remember. And as you know, the powers to be, the British and the French, were not interested in trying him and antagonizing the Arab street and the pan-Arabist nationalism that was burning in that area, Egypt, Syria, and North Africa, especially because they had financial interests in that region, oil. And
those were the three main interests that they had. Is that not correct?
It's correct, exactly. oil, and that's what happened. And so also, you know, with the presence of Suez Canal, which the British and the French were really interested in keeping it open to their merchandise and to their shipping. So unfortunately, they sold the Jewish people.
And of course, Nasser ultimately closed the Suez Canal anyway, at least for a while.
Exactly, yes.
Definitely. All right, guys, I'm now moving to question two. I've just explained what happened with the Holocaust Museum. The others have, and I'm just gonna turn to Rabbi. He may or may not have a comment about this. So Rabbi, do you have anything to add to the public campaign by so many people to get the Holocaust Museum to realize that Jews were victims outside of the European theater? Were you involved in any of that campaign?
I was involved behind the scene. I had a few meetings with the leadership of that. I have to say this, Edwin, even though you are Ashkenaz, but I must say the majority of Ashkenazi Jews are very Ashkenormative, if I can use that term.
No, but you couldn't until now, and from this point on, you will be able to use it, yes.
So they're Ashkenormative and Ashkecentrist in that sense. So anything beyond the boundary of Ashkenazi Jewry geography or history, either they don't know about it or they just don't care about it.
It was an invisible history to them. And by extension, the Holocaust Museum thought that your history was invisible.
Correct.
Here's from Max in Sacramento. How did you convince the U.S. Holocaust Museum to change their policy and include the Farhud? Well, I think I'll take a crack at that. The Holocaust Museum, the whole idea of the Farhud violated the mission statement of the Holocaust Museum, which was to commemorate European Jewry, the pogroms and extermination of European Jewry. And that is a very apt mission, but it's too restrictive and it leaves out the people of the Middle East, it leaves out the people of North Africa, and these people were directly impacted by Nazified involvement with the Arab Nazi alliance. Hitler had his own Lawrence of Arabia called Groba, and very few people, most scholars don't even know where Groba got his name. His name is A. Borg backwards, and that's Groba. And people are just amazed to hear that when I say that. And there were, although I was on the more authoritative side, there were angry people, there were protests, there were formal grievances filed with the Holocaust Museum. An entire group was set up to protest called Museum Watch. It was finally years later that the Holocaust Museum finally decided to include a small article on the topic. And now they do not deny it. They don't cover it as it should be, but at least they no longer have a code of silence on the topic. Here's Moshe in Be'er Sheva, Seven Wells. What hope is there of reclaiming or compensation for the property stolen? Lily, what do you know about that? Is that an area of your expertise?
Not quite, but I don't believe that there is, we are trying to, speak about the subject, to write about it, but the assets and the property of the Jews in Iraq, the property is not so, we cannot claim it because we don't have any relations with Iraq. We cannot, as Israelis, we cannot ask for it or claim it.
All right, Lynn, what do you know about any efforts to get compensation for the pilfered property of Iraqis?
Well, not just Iraqis, but Jews from all over the Arab and even Muslim world. There has been a campaign underway to claim compensation for lost or seized assets. There is even a Knesset law which was passed in 2010, and that said that no peace agreement may be signed unless compensation for Jewish refugees from Arab countries is on the agenda, is on
yes,
the table.
Yes, I remember that was just after my book came out, and people started to look around and is Israel and ask, why have we not dealt more forthrightly with this problem? And let me just add to what Lynn said. There have been many discussions about addressing all of these property claims from Iraq, from Libya, from all the countries that expelled some 850,000 Jews. And while there were efforts to get records, those efforts were intercepted, and without records, there really can't be much of a claim. And it's for another day, not forgotten, but to be remembered another day. Now I have a note.
Yes. Sorry, I just wanted to add that compensation isn't really the main issue because the Arab countries are basically in denial that the Jews actually left as refugees. And I think there is a moral lesson here. We need to get the other side, the Arab side, to recognize that they actually caused a mass exodus. And more than 50% of the Jews who live in Israel descend from these refugees or are themselves refugees. And this is massive. This is was a massive injustice. We need to get them to recognize this.
Yes, that's so important. In this case, the Nile is not just a river in Egypt. It's a state of mind amongst the Arab world. I've even seen them try to say, well, they wanted to go. They decided to leave their homelands of 2,700 years. So let me get this straight. They all decided they wanted to go, and they all decided to want to go on the same day, 850,000 people spread across a dozen or two countries, and they all decided to pass legislation depriving themselves of their property, their wherewithal, and they all decided to jump into trucks and go to the airport and wait to be airlifted out and expelled when the scarves were torn from their necks and the bracelets were torn from their wrists. And they all decided to just do that. And the answer is, of course, that's silly and stupid. Thanks for mentioning that, Lyn. All right, we've heard from them, but I'd like to hear from you. What hope is there on this question? What hope is there of reclaiming or property or compensation for any of the property, or for that matter, any kind of reparations to the families for what was done to the 850,000 expelled Jews?
Well, as you know, as president of Justice for Jews from Arab Countries that I represent, we have been now for almost 20 years working on that subject. First and foremost, we wanted to educate our own people, the rest of the Jewish people, and then the rest of the world, that they were such thing as Jewish refugees from Arab countries. The world did not recognize us. Our own Jewish co-religionists were not aware of it. Our own people who might be children or grandchildren of those refugees, they also were denying that because they did not want to talk about it. And so our first and foremost plan for Justice for Jews from Arab Country, JJAG, was education. Secondly, was bringing the plight to a legal level and a legal form. As you know, the United States Congress passed several resolutions in recognition of Jews from Arab countries as refugees, and also passed a binding resolution, I think was 185 of the House of Congress, that anytime that the United States will discuss refugees issues in the Middle East, they have to bring the Jewish refugee issue also to the table.
Yes, I remember that, and I believe Nadler was part of that effort.
That is correct. That is correct. Now, even Israel passed several laws and resolutions for that matter, one very similar to the United States, the recognition of Jewish refugees from Arab countries, that in any discussion of peace, their subject and their issue has to be discussed, and their just resolution to their plight. And of course, Israel also passed a law declaring November 30th as the commemoration day for Yom HaPlitin, for Refugee Day of Jews from Arab countries. But the idea of restitution, of financial restitution, it is there, it is still there, and we are working on it, let me put it that way. I could just tell you that the estimated value in money in today's dollars of possessions, property, wealth of the Jews from Arab countries that left in 10 Arab countries exceeds $300 billion.
Did you say $300 billion?
That's correct. $300 billion exceeds that. And real estate surface area of real estate, you're not gonna believe me, but we did the study, exceeds the size of Jordan and Kuwait together, put together, or Jordan and Lebanon territory put together. So when they ask us to return part of Judea and Samaria, we have plenty of more territory that they might need to return to us.
That's a fascinating observation. I think one that we'll have to discuss further another day. I have another quote here from someone called, all I know is PK in London. You're from London. I heard there was an airlift to Israel for Jews expelled by the Arab countries. Was that El Al? I'll answer that question. El Al provided the staircase. So you see pictures of these disenfranchised and dispossessed Jews landing in Israel. El Al did give the staircase, but the flights were organized, if you can believe this, by Air Alaska, and I have actually interviewed one of the pilots of Air Alaska. I met him at a Stand With Us event, and he still fondly remembers when he risked anti-aircraft fire to land the Jews. Now we're going to go to Merrily in Melbourne. How is it that 850,000 Jewish refugees are never mentioned and receive no assistance from the UN when all we hear about is Palestinian refugees? I'll let Lily take it first, and then we'll go to Lynn. Go ahead, Lily.
Well, I think that the Palestinians and the Arab world, Arab countries, the PRs and their PRs, the public relations are much stronger than the Israelis and the Jews. Well, I think it's all economic interests, and this is it.
All right, Lynn, what do you say? Why does the UN and all of the associated NGOs talk about Palestinian refugees and never Jewish refugees?
Well, I think the UN has 56, I think it is, Muslim members. They carry a lot of weight in the UN, and they managed to pass hundreds of refugees, all dealing with the Palestinian issue. And not one resolution deals with the Jewish issue. I think there's a mixture of reasons why this issue has not been has not been prominent. And partly it is the Israeli government's fault that for years they did ignore it. They thought if they raised the matter, it would only make the Palestinians raise the matter, their issue. But of course, the Palestinians never stopped raising their issue, and our issue was left by the wayside.
Now, you're so astute in that observation, Lynn. So how could we have expected the UN the larger community to take up the cause when we couldn't even convince the Jews of America, Israel, the government, and our own extended community to recognize what happened to these Jews, and not just one small community of Jews, 850,000 Jews spread across many countries.
But you put your finger on it, Edwin, because basically the American Jewish community is 90% Ashkenazi. And this wasn't really their history. This was not their background. It was not something they were familiar with. So why would they make an issue of something they didn't know about?
Well, Rabbi, I think you have something to add here, because you've already mentioned that the plight of Jewry has been recognized in the Israeli Knesset, in the U.S. House of Representatives. But what specifically, prior to International Farhud Day, has the UN done to assist the Jewish refugees, or at least recognize them?
Right. So also the British Parliament recognized the existence of Jewish refugees from Arab countries officially not long ago. The United Nations, practically nothing. However, in 1940, 1957 and in 1967, United Nations resolutions about refugees from the Middle East, referring mostly to Arab refugees, did include Jews as also a population of refugees. So legally, we have the term. But nothing was done about it, of course. But of course, the Arab refugees, they have been giving now so far over $85 billion in the last 70 years to UNRWA and all the resettlement issues. But the Jewish refugees, even though we were recognized as a refugee population by the United Nations in 1957 by the High Commissioner, and in 1967, in Resolution 252, right? 242, excuse me, Resolution 242 regarding Israel, you know, the 1967.
I think what you're referring to is that UN Resolution 242 makes reference to all refugees returning to their homes. And as far as I'm concerned, that would also include the 850,000. And very few people are aware of this, but look at the resolution, UN 242. There's no mention of Palestinians because at that time, the Palestinians did not exist as an identity in terms of Arabs. They just used the word Arabs.
There is a story behind that resolution. The Russian ambassador at that time was pushing to write Arab refugees in that resolution. The British and the American ambassadors, they said, if we're going to put Arab refugees, then we're going to have to add Jewish refugees, Arab and Jewish refugees. So the compromise was, we won't put Arab, we won't put Jewish, we just put all refugees.
Yes, I do remember that detail from looking at some of the background minutes, and I often mention that. But I'm so happy that you're adding this to the discussion, because most people are completely unaware of 242 and what it says. And that's why when I do my lectures, I say, okay, let's talk about 242.
Yeah, correct.
This is from Rona in New York. It says, Mr. Black, are you of Iraqi parentage? Am I of Iraqi descent?
You're one of us.
Yeah. I'm of Polish descent. That it's a well-known story, but I do not need to be of Iraqi descent to care for the injustice done to Iraqi Jews. I do not need to be an African to be concerned about the persecution of and the massacres of the Hereros in Southwest Africa. I do not need to be a Muslim to care about the disenfranchisement of the Shia during many regimes. I do not need to be a Native American to be concerned about what was done to the American indigenous people during the settlement of the United States. I could go on and on and on, but we only have 1 hour for today's show. So I'm happy to do what I did, and I did it mainly because no one else had. Here's Sonia from Richmond. That, not your Richmond, Lynn. I think it's Richmond, Virginia.
Disappointing.
Yeah. And I do miss coming to London. I was supposed to be there in June, and I'm so sorry that I did not attend due to this virus. Sonia from Richmond, what was the role of the British during the massacre? They were on the outskirts of Baghdad. So, Lynn, I'll give you a shot at that. Do you want to address that?
Well, yes, it's a very sore point because as Sonia says, the British Army were actually at the gates of Baghdad. They could easily have intervened to stop the massacre, but they didn't, because they didn't want to appear to be occupying the country and interfering in the internal affairs of Iraq. This is something unforgivable, really, because hundreds of Jews lost their lives as a result. But unfortunately, it is typical of a lot of of behavior by the colonial powers. And we have other examples where Britain or France, in many cases, did not intervene to stop a local massacre, or the forces of law and order took hours to arrive, and this sort of thing. And there's a kind of cynicism, saying, let them kill each other, you know, let them vent their frustrations, let them get on with it, and we'll stand by and watch them do it.
And I would like to add, in my research, I studied the military documents and the memoirs. One of the chief generals was the chair, and he had six different versions of his memoirs from the period. I got them all, I compared them all. And what was the British interest in Iraq? The British interest in Iraq was oil. They had the British Petroleum had its oil pipelines and pipelines and fields there. And Churchill needed to retain those for the war. And the Germans wanted that to fuel their invasion of Russia. And so, right, what they said is, look, we're here for the oil, not for human beings. Let me just get your little extra take on what the British did and did not do while they sat by on the outskirts and got hourly reports about these massacres against Jews.
Yes, look, unfortunately, we have seen it all throughout the Middle East, where the British government did whatever was good for them. Starting with the white paper, going to impeding immigration of Jews into the land of Israel prior to the establishment, sending many people back to Europe to die in the crematoria. All of that were unfortunately British actions and inactions to save the Jews. Look, the Farhud, the number of kills were in the 400, in the hundreds. Number of wounded in the thousands. Children orphaned. 242 children were orphaned by that Farhud. Shops looted. 2,371 shops and houses damaged. 6,558.
They virtually decimated the Jewish community.
Exactly. That is that 655. That means there were 6,558 families left with their homes damaged. That's a stratospheric number, and the total loss of value up to £3,500 at that time, which now would be 10 times that value. And so, yes, the British sat on the side and did nothing.
Here's one from Wendell Wendell in Tampa. Tell me more about the Arab Nazi connection. So I can just, I'll let Lyn go first. Lyn, what is the Arab Nazi connection in this whole thing?
The Arab Nazi connection, there was an alliance. There was a formal alliance between the pro-Nazi government under Rashid Ali al-Gaylani and and Germany and Italy, the Axis powers. They declared war against the Allies, against the British. So there was an official state of war against the Allies. The Nazi Arab alliance really originated as soon as Hitler came to power. The Mufti of Jerusalem sought an alliance with Hitler. The Germans were at first reluctant, but by 1939, they were perfectly happy to consider the Arabs as honorary Aryans. Mein Kampf was translated into Arabic.
And I might add, not only was Mein Kampf translated into Arabic, they got special dispensation from the foreign ministry to change the word anti-Semitic to anti-Jew.
Yeah, right. Yeah, that's right. And there were Nazi-style parties in the Arab world. There were young paramilitary groups.
You were going to tell us about the youth brigades in Baghdad. Go ahead, Lily.
Well, there were the youth movements, Al-Fatwa, and actually the teachers in at schools, they were asked to, or they had to wear the uniform of the Al-Fatwa, this youth movement. It was exactly like the Hitler Jugendrand, and it had a very big influence on the youth, on the young people, the Muslim and the Christians, young people.
Now I could say the Al-Fatwa was not only a Hitler Youth type organization, but they actually, many of them went to Nuremberg, marched into Nuremberg parades, the torchlight parades, and these were real Nazis. They weren't Nazi-style Arabs. They were real Nazis with a love for the swastika. They lionized Adolf Hitler. That's too much to talk about now, but we will one day. We have two more questions left. Henry in Palm Beach wants to know, how many Jews are left in these Arab countries? Lily, you want to take a stab at that?
I can say about Iraq that there are really maybe five Jews. All of them are elderly people, or most of them are elderly people who cannot, who do not want to or cannot go out of the country. And there is no Jewish community anymore in Iraq.
Go ahead. And the other countries?
In the other countries as well. In Egypt, I think there are only few Jews. In Libya, I think there is maybe one or two Jews. Lyn can shed light on this.
Go ahead, Lyn.
Okay, well, there are 4,000 Jews left in the Arab countries, mostly in Morocco and Tunisia. Unfortunately, there are no Jews left in Libya, no Jews left at all in Algeria. I heard at the last count there were 6 Jews in Egypt and 3 in Syria. And Yemen, apparently, they're all going to the UAE, according to latest reports.
Right. Okay. Well, now, here is our final question. This is Paul in Mexico City. Could this happen again? And if so, where? Okay, let's go around. Lily, where could this happen again?
Well, the brainwash is so strong, or the anti-Semitism is so strong. Yes, I'm afraid it can happen again. Maybe now in Arab countries there are no Jews or very few Jews, but I'm afraid it can happen elsewhere in other countries, but we hope that the state of Israel is a place that Jews can immigrate to, or can make aliyah to, and be safe here.
All right, now Lyn, what do you say? Could this ever happen again? And
yes,
where?
It can happen again. I'm alarmed at the level of anti-Semitism that we have in the West. We're losing the young people. They're all turning against the Jews. Anti-Zionism is the new anti-Semitism, if you like. Already we've found that anti-Semitic incidents are being downplayed and minimized and ignored. Jews are not considered to be an oppressed minority, and so therefore, you know, why make a fuss of anti-Semitic incidents? And this is a very worrying trend. You know, it might happen again. It might happen on a bigger scale than the individual incidents that we hear about almost daily. So I'm not very optimistic, I'm afraid.
I'm throwing it to you, Rabbi. Do you think that something like the Farhud could happen again anywhere in the world and perhaps even in the United States?
Unfortunately, yes. And I'm not a pessimist, but I'm a realist. Unfortunately, yes, it could happen. Could happen anywhere in the world, especially that this call coming from Mexico, not my birth country, but my growing up country in Mexico, that could happen anywhere in the world. And now that I'm living in the United States, unfortunately, it has happened here in the United States, not at that level. But yes, it happened, if you remember, in 1989, 90, in Crown Heights, when unfortunately a Jew driving for an emergency killed a 5-year-old child. Well, there were riots in Crown Heights against the Jewish community. They killed one person, they looted shop, they burnt houses. So it happened. And the way things are going today, this past year, prior to the pandemic, we have seen individual New Yorkers attacking Jews that look like Jews because either they have a beard or they have a capota or they have a hat, a shtreimel, just because they were Jews. So it happened, maybe not at that scale. It hasn't happened yet at that scale, but it could happen anywhere in the United States. It could happen anywhere in Europe, and eventually it could happen also in South America.
My response, not only can it happen again, if it does, it could happen in the following locations. The Fairfax area of Los Angeles, parts of Brooklyn, Marseille in France, areas in Denmark, in Norway, in certain towns in Eastern Europe. Ironically, I think we're less likely to see it in the Arab lands today as we are to see in the West, as Lyn says, where the hate has been exported, has been molded into a new anti-Semitism, which melds anti-Zionism and anti-Judaism. We have a naive new generation of Jews that does not know their history, and their parents know little more than them. So we're in trouble. And it remains to be seen in the very, very, very near future, in the very, very near places, whether this will happen again or whether it will not. Rabbi, please reach into your heart and give us a blessing for all the souls lost and all the damage done to the victims of the Farhud.
Of course, my dear friend, I will recite a memorial prayer for all those who perished at that time, for all their memories. מנוחה נכונה בשבעה עליונה תחת כנפי השכינה במעלת קדושים ותורים כזוהר רקיע מאירים ומזהירים וחלוס עסמים וחפרת אשמים וחרקת פשע וקרבת ישע וחמלה וחנינה מלפני שוכן מעונה וחולקת הבא לחי עולם הבא שם תמנת חיסת בישיבת נפשות הטובות שנפטרו בפרהות וכל אלה שנהרגו ונשרפו על קידוש השם רוח אדוני תניחם בגן עדן ויתפטרו מן על מעדן כרעותה אלא אמרי שמאיה והרעה המלך ברחמיו יחוס ויחמול עליהם וילווה עליהם השלום ועל משכבם יהיה שלום כדכתיב יבוא שלום ינוחו על משכבותם הולך נכוחו הם וכל בני ישראל השוכמים מהם בכלל הרחמים והסלחות ברכן ירסו ונאמר אמן.
Thank you so much, and I'm sure that all of our viewers do not need to speak the language to feel the power of that benediction from Rabbi Abadie. So I say thank you very much, Lily in Tel Aviv. Thank you very much, Lyn in London. Thank you very much, Rabbi.
Thank you, Edwin. God bless you.